Well, hello, class. Welcome to my first online lecture without an audience that I have ever given. I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing. I won't know if you guys are awake, engaged, or falling asleep on me. So the power is at your hands. You can rewind, you can pause, and you can fast forward at your pleasure, at your leisure. Let me start out by introducing myself. My name is Noah Franz. I am the pharmacy operations manager at Frederick Hospital. I've been with the organization now for 6 years and have held many responsibilities in a short period of time. Currently, I oversee our inpatient distribution, sterile and non-sterile, oversee our periprocedural space, or OR, and then I also oversee our inpatient pharmacy budget, which at a hospital of close to 700 beds, 79 operating rooms, and 39 clinics on campus, you can imagine the amount of drug spend we have on an annual basis, as well as the decisions we have to make to say, are we going to carry these drugs or not? And we're going to walk through some of those examples today on how we make those decisions and what goes through our minds as pharmacists, both clinically and on the, so both on the outcome and on the cost side. So I feel like a little bit of a nerd. This stuff is near and dear to my heart, and hopefully some of you guys will find a passion similar to mine. The objectives for today's lecture are going to be pretty basic, so we're going to keep it high level. I will be very direct with you guys on what I want you to walk away from this lecture knowing. From a high level, we're going to talk about pharmacoeconomics. We're going to introduce the topic, how it comes about, what it all entails. We're going to go over some examples on how we calculate it, how we determine what the outcomes versus costs, and how do we bring those two things together to make decisions on what we do and what we don't carry, and what each drug and what their value is to the organization or to the patient or to the payer. And really what I really want you guys to understand is that you guys, as pharmacists, will have to be making these recommendations, whether you're in my seat as a manager, whether you're talking to a patient about copays that they can or maybe can't afford. These are things and decisions that we sometimes make every day. We just don't realize it. And this lecture is going to put it into a little bit more of an academic format, but trust me that these are things and decisions that we make every day as pharmacists, even if I wasn't in my role as a manager and managing the budget at Frederick Hospital. Let's kick off our introduction to pharmacoeconomics with a very general term. So when you're car shopping, how do you select the right car for you? Now, I am a car guy. I love cars. I don't drive a fancy car, but it doesn't prevent me from liking cars. So when you're car shopping, and let's just say you're being a practical decision maker on what car you pick, how do you pick the right car? Oftentimes, many of you would say, well, I weigh the pros and cons. So what's the cost of the car? What features am I getting? How many seats does it have? What are the options I'm getting on the car? Am I getting cloth seats? Am I getting leather seats? And ultimately, you're making an economical decision, and pharmacoeconomics or buying the car, you're likely going to pick the car that you feel you get the biggest bang for your buck. So when you look at the definition of pharmacoeconomics, which is there on the formal definition is on the slide there, but it identifies measures and compares the costs and the consequences, which oftentimes the consequences are outcomes for our patients of pharmaceutical products and services. Pharmacoeconomics is ultimately saying what you pay for, do you get the equivalent amount of outcomes, results, or in the definition, consequences? Consequences in this definition are not meant to be a bad thing in every circumstance. So what they do here is the text outlines on the left-hand side, you have a cost input, and that drug, the Rx in the middle, has an outcome. The pharmacoeconomics equation is this simple. Based on the cost of the drug, what is the outcome? And the examples that we will go through in this lecture is helping determine, are the costs worth the outcome? And oftentimes we compare drugs to drugs, or maybe drugs from, I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, but how we compare different therapies or different services to make the best decision to get the best bang for our buck. So why is this important to me as a pharmacist and you as a pharmacist? So as a clinician, you always want to treat your patients with the product or the service or the drug that's going to provide the best outcome for them. Also, you have the people who are paying for it. So you either have the insurance company or the hospital or the payers, the patients, that there is also a cost that someone needs to pay for those outcomes. And you as pharmacists have some of the best knowledge both around outcomes as well as drug procurement and the costs of the medication. These are decisions that you will have to either support a patient in making those decisions someday, potentially if you work for a hospital, an insurance company, a pharmaceutical company. These are decisions that we as pharmacists are in some of the best seats to be help make. So breaking it down to the individual level, people making these decisions, is that a patient that comes to your window that gets prescribed a brand name combo product, for example, an ACE inhibitor tied to a diuretic, the copay for that drug might be, say, $100. If they choose to take those pills separately, the copay may be $4 for each one. So it's $100 versus $8. And that individual needs to make that value determination. Is the cost equal to the outcome that I'm going to get? And there's many, many factors that need to be played in there. Are they forgetful? Do they not like to swallow pills? Do they not want to take... You guys basically get that. Is it a convenience factor for them? And the patient ultimately needs to make that decision. Drug formulary. A good example is insurance companies have preferred products, helping to drive what they think is the best cost for the outcome. Hospitals have drug formularies where they go through P&T committee. Most hospitals only have one ACE inhibitor on formulary, one statin on formulary, because they pick the one that's more economical for the hospital, balancing cost and outcomes. I think we as healthcare providers and clinicians oftentimes get caught up in advertisements. We as pharmacists are the best people to critically evaluate what's being claimed by the pharmaceutical companies. They're not lying. It just might not be comparing the apples to apples or the outcomes to what we want to see. So on the next couple slides, we're going to see drug advertisements. I'm going to give you a little bit of a perspective from the hospital, talk about the pharmaceutical side, but we as pharmacists, like I said several times, sit in the best place to evaluate these drugs critically for the cost and the outcomes that they bring. One of the most controversial medications in most organizations right now is one that you would not think of. It's acetaminophen.
So the cost of a tablet of acetaminophen, honestly, the packaging to package the tablet costs more than the actual drug product. So a 1,000 milligram dose orally of acetaminophen costs anywhere between 2 and 5 cents. A dose of IV Tylenol costs about $40. Now, $40 doesn't seem like much, but you multiply that by Q6 hours, so 4 times a day, you're looking at about, oh boy, Noah, can you do your math here? $160 a day. $160 a day added to every patient on an inpatient stay is a lot of money. Now, IV Tylenol definitely has its advantages, and I'm not here to argue that. It does result in less opioids. It has proven to reduce pain for patients. It provides 2 times greater satisfaction for patients. But once again, it all depends upon how you equate it, or how you compare it to, or what you compare it to. So as you go through your rotations, many organizations you're going to see, some have it, some don't. And based on how they did their studies and their analysis, they either determined that it provided the cost equaled the outcome or greater. The outcome was greater than the cost. And some didn't. And it all depends upon how you evaluate it and what your organization values. Another one that's a little less known is Elvimapan or Enterig. It's an opioid antagonist for the GI tract, so oftentimes postoperatively patients get many opioids, and especially with abdominal surgeries, you want the GI tract to return to normal function as soon as possible. So the mix of pain control, opioids after surgery slows down the motility of the GI tract. Enterig as an opioid antagonist can help speed up that motility quicker after surgery while the patient has appropriate pain control on opioids. So you'll see in the study that study one, Enterig helped to improve improvements in GI recovery time versus placebo. So basically time to first bowel movement. First study was 20 hours, 26 hours, 14 hours. Oftentimes in these patients, you're waiting to discharge the patient. You're waiting for the first bowel movement to discharge the patient. The drug per tablet costs an organization on average about $175 a dose. The dose is given twice a day. So, with the cost of the drug, we have to start asking ourselves, does the cost of the drug equal a potential 20-hour reduction, or maybe a half a day early or discharge for the patient? Very, very difficult conversation as an organization to have, and we have to use pharmacoeconomical tools to help make those decisions. So how many of you guys have heard of a pharmacoeconomics pharmacist? Well, not necessarily by that title. I'm fortunate to work for an organization who has invested in about roughly five pharmacists that this is what they do every day. They also provide other resources to the organizations around medications and guidelines, but at the end of the day, one of their key roles is to help the organization control their drug cost and select the best drugs for the organization. So ultimately, this isn't a position. It's not a study that people go specifically to school for. We call them medication utilization pharmacists, or the department as a whole is called the Center for Medication Utilization, so CMU team. So if you're ever on rotation at Frederick, you will interact with a CMU pharmacist. And while they don't have direct patient interaction, they don't have direct reports, they're not managing a drug budget, I believe that they're single-handedly managing and controlling our drug costs very, very well, as well as providing really good quality data for the organization to make these decisions on what we do keep on formulary and what we don't. So, if this is of interest to you, I know one of your faculty member has a partial assignment to that CMU team at Froedtert, and I'm sure she'd be happy to talk to you about her role within our organization. Now, as we start transitioning into some more detailed, how do we actually do these studies? I've talked about costs and outcomes, and how do you actually get to the nuts and bolts to calculate this and make these decisions? A few general principles that we want to go over that when you're looking at cost is usually always in dollars. So anything that goes in when you look at cost, it's monetary, it's dollars. Outcomes can vary based on the type of study used, but ultimately, when you're doing a comparison, the outcomes need to be like. So they need to be, outcomes need to be apples to apples. So if you're measuring reduction in blood pressure, both drugs you're comparing have to have an outcome of blood pressure reduction. One can't be blood pressure reduction and the other be prevention of stroke, for example, or prevention of heart attack. Apples to apples for both cost in and apples to apples for outcomes. There are four studies that we're going to go over in the next several slides. These, I want you to be able to identify what type of study is being used based on the outcomes measurement. Okay, so this is a summary slide, but for a test, for example, I would want you to be able to tell me with a brief summary of how the study was conducted, whether it was a cost-effective analysis or a cost-utility analysis, and the outcomes will help drive what type of study should be done. The first of the four studies, cost minimization analysis. Now, this one's an easy one to get kicked off with, and ultimately, this one needs to be used when outcomes are assumed to be equivalent. So, glipizide and glyburide, in this instance, if we're comparing them in the study, for example, it needs to show the exact same amount of A1C reduction. So, assuming that that is true, all you're really doing is comparing the costs to one another. So, some will make the argument, is this just a cost analysis or is it a true pharmacoeconomic study? You guys can be the judge of that. The textbook put it in there. So we will go over it. Also, one of the things I want you guys to know for the test for each one of these four studies are the pros and the cons of using it. So for this one, a pro is it's a very easy study to do. A pro is that outcomes need to be met, need not be measured. So you just have to assume that outcomes are equivalent. But really understanding that in the con side is it a true pharmacoeconomic study? And also, are the outcomes truly equivalent and how do you prove that? The second study is my personal favorite, the cost-benefit analysis. So both the inputs and the outputs are in monetary terms. So the cost and or the cost and the outcomes are in dollar amounts. This allows you to compare outcomes with similar or unrelated outcomes. An example would be you provide a pharmacokinetic service versus a diabetes clinic. So the service can also be looked at as the same as the drug. So the cost to run the clinic may or may not be the same for each one. But then your outcomes, so what are you doing? What are you providing? Is a pharmacist cheaper than a physician? Does the pharmacokinetic clinic prevent more readmissions than the diabetes clinic? Or is the reimbursement higher in the pharmacokinetic clinic than the diabetes clinic? Or does the pharmacokinetic clinic help reduce time that patients are on antibiotics in the outpatient setting because they spend more time in therapeutic range? All of those factors or those outcomes need to be put into dollar terms. And then you can really do the cost to outcomes analysis. Application to this in practical life is you do a cost benefit ratio. What is the cost to the benefit? So if the cost is $140,000 to implement a pharmacokinetic clinic or a diabetes clinic, what benefits are you getting? And ultimately, you say you prevent readmissions and you prevent readmissions for 70 patients a year. If the cost is greater than the benefit, so the ratio is greater than one, it's easy to say don't implement. If the cost divided by the benefit is less than one, you have a return on investment. A pretty simple calculation to determine which one is greater. I think ultimately the hard part for this one is how do you put clinical outcomes into dollar terms? So in the cons section, you'll see that it's difficult to place monetary values on health outcomes. One of the pros, though, is that it compares treatment options and inputs in more apples-to-apples terms. And you can really determine the best way to spend your money or the best way to get an ROI on your dollar investment. So the third one we're going to go over today is the cost-effective analysis. Well, I said the cost-benefit analysis was my favorite. The text suggests that this is the most common one used, and I would tend to agree with them. For this one, the distinguishing factor is that the outcomes are measured in natural units or in units in general. So examples used here on the slide are blood pressure reduction, LDL or cholesterol reduction, symptom-free days, some type of units of measure that is not dollars. So it calculates cost effectiveness ratios. On the next slide, we'll be able to calculate some of those together as well as the incremental cost effectiveness ratio. Once again, we'll calculate that on the next slide together. Examples used kind of for the outcomes are confirmed healed ulcers, symptom-free days. Another study looks at good glycemic control. Obviously, the study defines what glycemic control is. Clearly, the one that you see used most often in publications. So pros for this one is it's readily understood health outcomes. So blood pressure reduction, very, very objective measure compared to the some of the other studies we look at. Cons to it is comparators must have outcomes in the same units. So gotta have apples to apples. You can't measure mean arterial blood pressure in one and then blood pressure reduction or systolic or diastolic blood pressure reduction in another. So apples to apples on the outcomes. So let's run through a couple examples here. This is where the fun stuff starts happening. So as you'll see on the left-hand section or the left third of the screen that, let's use an LDL drug or a cholesterol lowering medication. So we'll call it a statin. Cost for a 12-month prescription for the current therapy that's on the market, we'll call it simvastatin for fun. For a 12-month cost of the medication, it's about $1,000. And studies show that it lowers LDL over 12 months by 25 points. The new medication, which is, let's say, Crestor or rosuvastatin, costs over 12 months, costs the patient or the health system $1,500, but it does lower the LDL by 30, so 5 points more than our current medication, simvastatin. When you look at the average cost per reduction, so now we're moving to the middle section. So for each LDL point that it reduces, what is the cost? My slides working here. Rookie doing this online, my goodness. So the average cost per reduction in LDL for our current medication, simvastatin, it costs $40 per point reduction. Rosuvastatin, while it reduces it more, it costs more, $50 per point reduction. So, another way to look at this is, what is the incremental cost per reduction in LDL? So, we've got our formula here. You take the cost of the new drug, the annual cost, minus the cost of the current drug, so $500 difference, divided by the difference in outcomes. So, 500 divided by 5 for each point reduction, you're paying an extra $100. So now we as a health system have to decide, with many, many other factors involved, does the extra benefit of the new medication rosuvastatin, while the outcomes are better, is the additional cost worth it? Our final of the four studies is the cost utility analysis. This one is interesting. Some of you may not have seen many studies like this, but nonetheless, it is used widely. Primarily, I have seen it personally used in oncology agents. So it's the most common unit conducted is quality adjusted life years. So what it does is it not only looks at the outcomes, but it looks at the utility or the quality of those outcomes. So in the example we use, or in an oncology agent, it might keep a patient alive longer, say 6 months, 12 months, but what is the quality of their life? And honestly, they put a value on that quality. So they may say it's 1.0, patients fully, or a full quality adjusted year, you know, if they're fully active, they're doing all activities of daily living, it might get a quality factor of 1.0. If the patient has to spend half their time sitting down, they're exhausted, has to get blood transfusions, they may give it a quality factor of 0.5. If the patient spends those last months of their life in the hospital, they may give it a 0.1 factor for the quality of life. So just because the outcome of years of life goes up doesn't necessarily mean that the quality of those last years of life are always comparable to maybe a different drug. Similar to what I was alluding to earlier, this is a good study when both morbidity and mortality are both important outcomes of a treatment. Some pros and cons for this type of study. Pro is different health outcomes can be compared. So, really just focusing on years of life or quality years of life, attempts to adjust for quality of outcomes. So, like I was alluding to, just because the patient is alive longer doesn't necessarily mean that quality is there for that patient. Cons, it's difficult to determine an accurate utility adjustment, so who's to say that a quality adjustment factor for a patient who just has to get more transfusions, maybe a transfusion every or an infusion every 2 days, who's to say that that's a quality factor of life reduction of 0.2? It's not a precise science. There's no consensus on how to adjust for that quality. However, the internal validity of a study adjustment is clearly there. It's the external validity, comparing different studies to maybe different studies, is where you get into that more non-scientific, non-consensus concerns with the cost utility analysis. In summary, like I said earlier, we hear it 100 times throughout your curriculum. United States spends a ton of money on healthcare. While a ton of money, there are still limited resources, and we need to use those resources appropriately. And the percentage of that total spend on healthcare, on pharmaceuticals, has steadily increased, primarily because the innovation in therapy that is shining even more light on the ability for us to analyze drug costs and the outcomes that it brings. So you as pharmacists and the principles of pharmacoeconomics helps us as pharmacists and clinicians make better clinical and business decisions. It's a relatively new topic. It's a relatively new environment within the healthcare industry. We really use and blend those clinical outcomes with healthcare economics. And it's, like I said, it's a new field, and we are great middlemen to the outcomes and cost side, because we as pharmacists are probably trained better, and we have different lenses on at different times. So for the test, I really want you to understand the four studies. I want you to be able to know the pros and cons of the study. And I really want you to understand and potentially be able to calculate a cost-effectiveness ratio. So use that slide that has the calculation on it. Understand it. Nothing will be drastically hard, but similar to the NAPLEX, you need to know how to do that. Now, we focused a lot on money and focused a lot on maybe blood pressure reduction per cost per point reduction in blood pressure. Ultimately, the decisions that we make as healthcare providers are not solely based on dollars and cents. There are social and legal and ethical and political considerations, as well as outcome considerations and physician preferences that we have to factor into our decision-making process. The ability to tie a value or do a pharmacoeconomic study really just helps add some objectivity to the conversations. Right, so really quickly here, case example, just to drive the point home, is that there is a study done looking at IV antibiotic administration for the following frequencies. One antibiotic hit Q8 hours, and one was once daily. They had equivalent outcomes, and the ultimate cost question is, what frequency minimizes cost? So while when you really look at it at just the drug acquisition cost, you see that it's $12 cheaper for a day supply, of the every 8 hours dose. But there's other things you need to factor in. Now, let me circle back here real quick. This is a cost minimization study because we're assuming equivalent clinical outcomes. Okay? So when we look at just drug costs for every 8 hours, the drug acquisition costs, it's cheaper for the Q8 hours drug. But when you start adding up some of those costs, so it's an IV antibiotic, there's a cost to put it into a fluid. Do you put it in the fluid once a day or 3 times a day? The prep costs, so the labor involved in it, and then the administration costs to give it to the patient once a day versus 3 times a day. And all of a sudden, you look at the cost of the drug, and while at the surface level, the drug acquisition cost for Q8 hours looked lower. But then when you factor in everything around it, it's actually cheaper to give it once daily. Transitioning from the intro to pharmacoeconomics and the four essential equations that we use to kind of calculate costs and then the outcomes, we're going to transition into a new topic. The title doesn't seem that in depth, but decision analysis and then the decision analysis tree. And this one is going to be a little bit more intensive, a little bit harder to describe, but ultimately an extremely powerful tool. So when you look at our agenda or our objectives for this section, is we want to define decision analysis. We want to list the steps and understanding the appropriate steps used to conducting the decision analysis. And then ultimately, we're going to review a decision analysis tree and be able to determine and calculate the best drug option based on the cost. So personally, myself, I'm a very visual person. So the decision analysis and the decision tree analysis really helps me understand different scenarios based on different outcomes or different factors played in. So really looking at the definition, it applies an analytical method for systematically comparing different decision options. We talked about how it visually helps facilitate the calculation of values needed to compare different options. And ultimately, what we're going to do as an example is that a drug might have a side effect profile of 7 to 15%. Another drug might have a side effect profile of 10 to 25%. There is uncertainty in that, and based on what level of adverse events you pick, one drug may be cheaper than the other. So it allows you to really do an in-depth analysis and sensitivity analysis, which we won't get into today, but allows you to change and adjust those numbers based on what you or your organization feels is most accurate. So I want to walk through the steps in decision analysis, and there's 6 steps on the screen. We're going to talk about them from a high level. I want you guys to understand these at a very basic level. Don't need to go into extreme detail here. Some of it may seem like common sense, but I definitely think it's worth going over here. So step one, you want to identify the specific decision. You want to identify what is the question that you are trying to answer, and from what perspective are you trying to answer it. Step two is like any study that you're trying to do. So let's say you're trying to compare one drug, or you're trying to bring a drug to market, or you're trying to bring a drug to formulary. You usually want to compare to the standard of care. So the standard of care is the most well-known product or the gold standard on the market. That will create an effective analysis. So drawing the decision tree, or the decision tree analysis structure. On the next slide, you're going to see that decision tree. And at every junction is a decision point. And we'll go into that more depth. So we're going to spend most of our time that we have left together, virtually together, on step three. Step four, establishing those probabilities for the outcomes of the treatment alternatives. Oftentimes you get that from the literature or you're doing that study. Step five, we will also do some of step five, and I want you guys to be able to do step five, is perform those calculations. And then last, we won't spend any time on, but usually it's to conduct that sensitivity analysis, which I'm sure you guys have done in some of your calculations class in the past. So the decision tree. Starting from the left and moving right, we're using antibiotics. So we're going to use an antibiotic example throughout the rest of the lecture. What are you trying to treat? You're trying to treat an infection. Antibiotic A is your drug that you have. Antibiotic B is the standard of care. Antibiotic A, as you'll see as you move right, you'll say, what is the probability of clinical success? What is the probability of clinical failure? So you'll see in the next couple slides that we put a probability number there, so we're making that kind of branching decision or branching node where there are different clinical outcomes. Same thing goes for antibiotic B. As you move right down by antibiotic B, they're going to have a different clinical success rate and a different clinical failure rate. Once again, as you continue to move right from the clinical success or clinical failure, you have another decision mode. There will be a probability for adverse events, a probability for no adverse events. And then at the end, you see a triangle. Ultimately, we will put a cost of care in that spot. So the example we're using is antibiotic A has a clinical success of 90%, adverse events of 10%, the drug cost is $600, and the cost of adverse events is $1,000. As you move to antibiotic B, you'll see that the clinical success is less, adverse events are higher, but the drug cost is $100 less than antibiotic A. So what we're trying to determine is based on these adverse events, clinical success ratios, and drug costs, what is the best drug? What drug provides the best outcome or value for what we're paying for it? So what you guys will see here, and I'll try and draw and talk through this, is, let me pick a different color here. Let's do red. So antibiotic A, ignore the cost right here for a second. This is our drug that we have in question. Clinical success rate we said was 90%, so 0.9. Clinical failure, 10% or 0.1. This adds up to a probability of 1.0. Every time you have one of these sections, it needs to add up to 100% probability. So as we look at antibiotic B, ignore the cost for a second. We said the clinical success rate was 80%, therefore the clinical failure rate is 20% or 0.2. These together add up to 1.0. You have another decision node. We said that for antibiotic A, adverse events was 10%, 0.1. Therefore, no adverse events was 0.9. If you recall from the previous slide, feel free to go back and look. For antibiotic A, we said the drug cost was $600. Also, for antibiotic A, we said that the adverse events, if happened, cost the organization or the health system $1,000. So, if a patient got antibiotic A and had adverse events, the total cost of care would be $1,600. Same goes for the clinical failure decision part of the decision tree. No adverse events. Just because you had clinical failure or clinical success doesn't mean you may or may not have adverse events. So for in this example, you have clinical failure with no adverse events, you still had to pay for the $600 drug. Moving down, antibiotic A had clinical failure, but you had adverse events. So the patient still received the drug, had adverse events, even though it didn't work, it still cost the health system $1,600. Same thing goes for antibiotic B as we move to the right. The adverse events ratio was 15% for this one, so you'll see that 0.85, 0.15 adds up to 1.0 again. The difference here is the drug cost is $100 less. So, $500 for the drug, $500 plus adverse events of $1,000 equals $1,500. On the next slide, we will do these calculations backwards, but here you will see that a prelude to the answer is that antibiotic B, even with the lower success rate in adverse events, antibiotic B is cheaper. Antibiotic B is $650 versus $700 for antibiotic A. Now that was a lot. The great thing is that this was a recording, so you can go back and re-listen to that if you need to also in your text. It does a nice job of outlining this exact example. So how did we determine that antibiotic B was $650 and antibiotic A was $700 cost to the healthcare system? So the decision tree on the left is the exact same as the previous slide. So let's walk through how we determine this. We multiplied the two probabilities for each branch of this tree. So the clinical success was 0.9 or 90%. The chance of having an adverse event was also, or not having an adverse event, was 90%. So what you'll see is we multiplied 0.9 times 0.9 to get the probability of that happening, multiplied by the cost of giving a patient the drug, $600 with no adverse events. Now, what you're going to do is you're going to do that for each node, which I will draw out here. You're going to do the same calculation for success with adverse events. So you're going to multiply 10% or 0.1, which I will underline here for you guys, by the probability of clinical success, 0.9, multiplied by 0.9. So ultimately, the chance of getting to this end result right here is 9% or 0.09. So you multiply 0.09 by the cost of $1,600, the cost is $1,600 to get 144. Now you do that calculation again, and you do it for each branch of antibiotic A. So now you have clinical failure, 10% chance. So of that 10% chance or probability, there's a 90% probability that there are no adverse events. This costs $600. 0.1 multiplied by 0.9 multiplied by that cost. So over here you have that 10% chance of clinical failure, chance of not having adverse events equals 9%. 9% multiplied by $600 is 54. And you can continue to do that math all the way down. So we do the same thing for antibiotic B. Once again, another opportunity for you guys to pause and rewind and really understand how we get to that cost for each drug. So, like I said earlier, antibiotic A or antibiotic B might have a range of adverse events. So, for example, antibiotic B in the last example we did said it had adverse events of 15%. But the range actually in the study might be 15 to 20%. So we would want to do this study and say, what if adverse events were 20%? So what I want you guys to do is I want you guys to draw out on paper or mentally the decision tree on the right based on the information you have on the left. And I want you to come up with the idea of which antibiotic is cheaper to use. So the adverse events for antibiotic B is changing. So now would be probably a good time to pause the lecture, take some time and calculate out which antibiotic would be best or cheapest based on all these factors to add to your formulary. Now that you took some time to draw it out, calculate it yourself. This is how your decision tree should be set up based on the information given on the last slide. And then here are your calculations to determine the cost of antibiotic A and the cost to the healthcare system of antibiotic B. Ironically, if antibiotic B has an increased adverse events rate, the cost is equivalent to the healthcare system. Each drug costs $700. Then once again, there is the decision tree analysis with that $700 ultimately built in at the end. It's a wash. I want to thank you guys for bearing with me through this online voiceover lecture. I really wish I was there in person with you guys, but fortunately this year I wasn't able to be. I'm sure your instructor will send out my email address. Focus on those main topics that we talked about in the lecture. This may not, my last advice, or in real life, we don't necessarily always do these calculations, but you better believe that as pharmacists, as I said many times, these are decisions that you're faced with every single day, whether it's in retail, you're talking to a patient, or you're talking to a physician in the medical ICU at Froedtert that wants a new therapy, but really doesn't understand and is just looking at the outcomes. But not necessarily factoring in the cost or factoring in the full picture. And also the other perspective, you may have a manager or a finance person who's just looking at the cost and not understanding the whole picture that a drug can prevent readmissions or a drug can reduce nurse workload or ultimately can reduce or increase patient satisfaction. So I really hope you guys had the opportunity to take something away from this lecture. Once again, feel free to email me with any questions. Unfortunately, I didn't put it on the slide here, but I'm sure your teacher or course coordinator will get that information out for you. Thanks, guys. Stay safe, and hopefully we'll be seeing you around on rotations next year.